This is Zach, Devin, and Ken. We'll be talking to you about our final project, which is a survey of unconditionally verifiable voting cryptoschemes. So we saw in lecture how we can apply some of the cryptographic techniques that we've learned throughout this course, in particular to the problem of voting, and some of the problems and complexities that arise when we do so. So to start out, we'll recap the roles and permissions involved in voting schemes. Next, we'll talk about some of the properties and goals that exist in the ideal voting crypto schemes. And lastly, we'll tell you about some of the schemes that we explored during this project and discuss how they relate to some recently published work in the area.
So in terms of the roles that are involved in a crypto in a voting system, there's non-voters who are not allowed to interact with the system at all. There's the voters, verifiers, and tallyers. Voters are able to cast their ballots, and they need to be able to verify that their ballot has been cast and successfully counted. It's important that they cannot sell their vote. This is an ideal situation. The verifiers' main job is to distinguish voters from non-voters, but it's also very important that they're not able to determine how an individual client voted. The tallyer is able to count ballots and produce a verifiable result of the election. And again, it's very important that they can't know how any individual voter voted. And it's also possible for tallyers to be the same users as voters.
So some of the ideal properties that we satisfy in a voting scheme, particularly cryptographic voting schemes, first I'll talk about anonymity. For us, anonymity means that nobody can see who a particular voter voted for. As we saw with the public bulletin board scheme, it's okay to see who voted, but it's not okay to see who each voter voted for. Next, I'll talk about verifiability, which for us has two different components. The first of which is verification of whether or not your vote was included in the final tally. It's okay for verifiability to be probabilistic, so you could have some probability of knowledge that your vote was in fact included. It's also possible, as we'll explore later, that verifiability can be ephemeral, meaning that only within some brief time window after the election closes are you able to verify that your vote was counted, and thereafter it's not possible. The second form of verifiability ensures that the public can verify the outcome as reported by the election is in fact the correct outcome. And I'll lastly point out that verifiability can be conditional given trust in some third parties. It might be the government, it might be the election organizers, or so on, depending on the voting scheme. And lastly, I'll talk about integrity. Integrity has a few different aspects, the first of which is ensuring that only eligible and valid voters in the voting scheme are capable of voting and that no one else can do so. These voters can only vote once. The scheme ideally also makes it very difficult to sell votes. And lastly, we need to ensure that voters can't be disenfranchised and by any party, which means that essentially voters cannot be deprived of the right to vote if they're otherwise eligible to do so. Our main focus is mainly on verifiability. In particular, as we mentioned, we're interested in unconditionally verifiable voting crypto schemes. However, at the same time, we're able to make some guarantees about both anonymity as well as integrity.
Before going into the details of the crypto systems that we explore, I briefly want to go over the concept of blind signatures. Now, the idea of a blind signature is that I can request an authority to sign a message without telling that authority what the message is. Essentially, it's having authority sign a ciphertext and then being able to extract a signed plain text from that signed ciphertext. For now, we'll black box it, but it can be done with RSA, but special measures must be taken to prevent the forging of other valid signatures, and the RSA key that is used can only be used for blind signatures. I can give details about this. So we devised three schemes, the first of which we call the registration, commit, reveal, or RCR scheme, and the next two are derivations and simplifications of that scheme, which we call the registration vote, or RV scheme, and the verify vote, or the VV scheme. So in the RCR scheme, the first phase is registration. The voter generates a private and public key, and then sends a proof of his identity and eligibility to vote to the verifier, who then blind signs the voter's public key. Then during the commitment phase, the voter decides how they're going to vote, fills out a ballot, and commits to that ballot using a commitment scheme that is both binding and hiding. They then sign this commitment with their secret key, and send their signed public key and the signed commitment to the verifier. The verifier then validates the signatures, and if they check out, publishes that information to their public bulletin board. Then during the reveal phase, the voter verifies that the verifier had published the commitment on the public bulletin board, and if so, sends his public key and the revocation of his commitment to one or more talliers. The talliers then verify that the revelation reveals a commitment published on the public bulletin board of the verifier, and if so, they publish the revelation on their own public bulletin boards. So this scheme has the nice properties of being anonymous so long as the voter chooses not to reveal his identity. The voter can simply reveal his identity by giving away his secret key or signing something. In addition, it is unconditionally verifiable in the sense that any voter can verify that his vote was counted since all the votes are publicly available once they are revealed on the public bulletin board. In addition, anyone can stop and vote the ballots to find the final tally and verify that it's correct. In addition, partisan disenfranchisement is hard because the only way for a vote to be ignored because a party doesn't like who the vote is for is if all the talliers agree not to count a certain vote. If one tallier accepts the revelation of the vote, then the vote is counted. So some problems with the system are that it's easy to sell the vote. The voter can simply give away his secret key and his signed public key, and then anyone can vote as the voter. And this is especially true if voting is performed remotely. And it is unnecessarily complex, which brings us to our first simplification, the RV scheme. In the RV scheme, the registration phase is exactly the same as in the RCR scheme, with the blind signing of a public key. The voting phase of the RV scheme involves the voter signing his ballot with his secret key and then sending his signed public key and signed ballot to the talliers. The talliers then verify the signatures and if they check out, publish the signed public key and signed ballot onto their public bulletin board. This scheme has exactly the same security properties as the original RCR scheme. It has anonymity, giving trust in the voter. It has unconditional verifiability, and disenfranchisement is only possible with complete collusion of all the talliers. And it's simpler. What we realized was that the commitment actually didn't bias any additional security problems. It just merely deferred the potential for disenfranchisement through collusion to later. Some problems with the system are that it's still possible to sell the vote, and there's still unnecessary complexity. So our final simplification, the VV scheme, involves the voter generating a random ballot ID, filling out his ballot, and then having the verifier sign his ballot and ballot ID. And then he simply submits the signed vote and ballot ID to talliers, and then the talliers verify the signatures and publish to their public bulletin boards. Now this system has the same pros as the RCR and RV scheme. It's also simpler, and it's also harder to sell the vote because the proof that a voter owns a vote is ephemeral. That is, the voter can prove that he is voting in a certain way once he gets the signed ballot ID and ballot back from the verifier, because it hasn't been published yet. He's the only one who has that vote, and anyone can verify that it's a valid vote. But once he sends it to the talliers and it's published, it's in the public domain. So anyone can claim that that was their vote, but they have no way of proving that it actually was their vote. Some cons of this system are that the voter still can sell his vote, even though it's harder. In addition, we noticed that this scheme is very similar to a system published by Ibrahim et al. In 2003, which shows the difficulty of creating unique crypto systems.
Okay, so I'd like to very briefly talk to our future work we'd like to try and do. So we'd really like to find a cryptographic way of preventing vote selling as opposed to a legal way. We'd like to analyze the trust that a voter has to place in each of the different third parties and hopefully minimize that as much as we can. And finally, we'd like to look at extending other approaches like homomorphic tallying, hopefully layering our system with that or layering that on top of our system to get some of the good properties of both systems. Thanks for listening, and we can take any questions.
Questions? Vote selling is tough with vote voting. Once you know what you're doing, the voting is tough.
Some of
the
schemes that will work well are controlled by ballot.
Excellent talks today. Thank you all. Should I come to the next class?